Hi guys, welcome back to my channel. My name is Ziad, Crohn's disease patient, NHS worker and educator, here bringing you IBD facts and taboo breaking chats. Don't forget to like, comment, share and subscribe to my channel. So let's get started. Hello and welcome to this lesson on how IBD affects the body. So the way IBD can affect the body, it can cause complications that occur outside of the intestines. These are known as extra-intestinal complications. It should be noted that not everyone will develop these complications and not everyone will respond the same way to treatment for these complications. So let's first look at the cardiovascular system. So there's been an increasing amount of studies that have shown people with IBD actually have a higher risk of developing cardiovascular disease. It has been shown that in those with Crohn's disease, there's about a 2 to 3-fold increased risk of developing venous thromboembolisms, which can lead to the development of deep vein thrombosis or pulmonary embolisms, with the risk being higher during flare-ups. Now, the reason why it's thought people with IBD are at increased risk of cardiovascular disease because it's thought to be due to the inflammation that is seen in IBD causing higher levels of inflammatory substances in the body. This, along with homocysteine, which is a chemical the body makes to break down amino acids, which is also linked to increasing the risk of heart disease. And it's been seen that these levels of homocysteine are higher in people with IBD. And so the presence of all these inflammatory substances in the body and blood can cause damage to the lining of the blood vessels. This is known as endothelial dysfunction. And it has been seen that endothelial dysfunction and the sticking of platelets are actually precursors of heart disease. So the next body part we're going to look at is the eyes. So the first eye condition we're going to look at is something called episcleritis. So this is where the membrane that covers the eyes becomes inflamed. Episcleritis is a common condition in young adults which causes the eye to become red and sore and is often mistaken as conjunctivitis. In most cases, it will resolve by itself when the underlying cause, such as IBD, is treated, but some anti-inflammatory medication and lubricants can be given to help the healing process. In uveitis, this occurs when the part of the eye called the uvea becomes inflamed. There are four main groups of uveitis depending on which part of the eye it occurs in, and uveitis can be treated using eye drops or steroids, and it is a serious condition that could potentially lead to sight loss. The next condition is called scleritis. This is a rare complication of IBD that can also lead to sight loss, and it is where the sclera, which is the white outer layer of the eye, becomes inflamed. Scleritis can be treated with antibiotics, corticosteroids, and non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, depending on what caused it in the first place. So now we're going to look at liver and gallbladder. So the liver is one of the biggest organs in the human body, and it carries out many important functions such as fat, carbohydrates, and protein metabolism. The liver produces a substance called bile, storing it in the gallbladder, which when released through bile ducts that drain into the small intestines, can assist in the digestion of fats and vitamins. People with IBD can suffer from inflammation of these bile ducts, which is known as a rare condition called primary sclerosing cholangitis, or PSC for short. It is mainly seen in people with ulcerative colitis and can lead to liver complications such as cirrhosis and liver failure. It's thought that toxins produced by intestinal inflammation causes the bile ducts to become inflamed, which then leads to the development of PSC, which can impact on the ability of the liver to carry out its normal functions. People with IBD can also develop gallstones, which are hard deposits of cholesterol. The causes of gallstones are still unknown, but it's thought that an imbalance in the chemical properties of bile could lead to the formation of gallstones. Now, even though gallstones are quite common in the general population, causing no symptoms or even problems, these stones can move from the gallbladder to the bile ducts, causing a blockage, which will then require keyhole surgery to remove. In those with Crohn's disease where inflammation of the ileum is present, there is a reduction in the reabsorption of bile salts that were released into the duodenum during digestion. This results in less bile salts and cholesterol being in the gallbladder, increasing the risk of gallstones to form. And it's not uncommon for those for IBD to have granulomas, which are a collection of inflammatory cells in the liver, and this can cause a condition known as granulomatous hepatitis. This is usually due to the presence of another condition such as PSC or an infection, and treatment focuses on targeting the source of the cause in the first place. It's also common for those with IBD to have collections of fat droplets in the liver due to a condition called hepatic steatosis, which can be caused due to malnutrition or corticosteroid use, causing the accumulation of fat within the liver. Moving on to the joints of the body, the inflammation caused by Crohn's disease in the small intestines can result in reduced uptake of essential nutrients such as calcium and vitamin D, which are important for bone growth and health. And it's not uncommon for people with IBD to suffer from arthralgia, which is the presence of pain within a joint without the presence of inflammation, such as fingers, elbows, ankles, knees, and the back. Enthesitis, the inflammation of the area where a tendon or ligament attached to your bone within a joint. And arthritis, which is the name given to the presence of inflammation within the actual joints. And there are two types of arthritis that those with IBD can suffer from. It can be peripheral arthritis, which is a type of arthritis usually affecting the large joints on the periphery of the body and can be classified into either type 1 or type 2 peripheral arthritis, or axial arthritis, which is a type of arthritis that affects the joints of the spine and pelvis and is also known as spondylitis or spondyloarthropathy, and causes pain and stiffness in the lower spine and sacroiliac joints. Now, unlike peripheral arthritis, this type of arthritis can cause damage to the areas it affects, which can cause difficulty in carrying out everyday tasks due to reduced motion. Next, we're going to look at the bones of the body and how IBD can affect the bones. So bone health is monitored through using a dual energy X-ray absorptiometry scan or a DEXA scan, which can measure the density of the bones, allowing the detection of bone conditions such as osteoporosis, where the bones start to thin and become weaker and more fragile, making them more susceptible to fractures. Osteopenia, which is the term given when bone density is at the low end of normal and near the level to be considered as osteoporosis. In osteopenia, the bone is weaker than what it should normally be, but will not fracture as easily in comparison to osteoporosis. And then there's osteomalacia, which is a term used to describe soft bones. In osteomalacia, ossification does not occur properly, and collagen fibers are continuously being made and not covered with minerals, making the bones soft. So then why does IBD increase the risk of loss of bone density? Well, bone density loss is a natural process. During the natural process of aging, bone becomes thinner and weaker. But in those with IBD, there is an increased risk of developing osteoporosis, osteopenia, and osteomalacia due to corticosteroid use, inflammation, nutritional deficiencies, and even smoking. Next, the body part is the kidneys. The way IBD can affect the kidneys is by causing inflammation of the glomeruli of the kidneys. This is known as glomerulonephritis, which is a term used to describe the inflammation of the tiny networks of capillaries within your kidneys that are located inside a structure called the Bowman's capsule. The purpose of this network of capillaries is to filter the blood, allowing waste products to be released from the body via urine while keeping an essential proteins in the body. IBD can also increase the chances of kidney stones to occur. The way in which IBD does this is by inflammation of the intestines can cause a reduction in the amount of fat that is absorbed from the diet, leading to fat malabsorption that causes an increase in a substance called oxalate. Because of inflammation in the small intestines can cause inadequate amounts of bile salts to be reabsorbed back, which leads to less fat being absorbed. Calcium then prefers to bind onto this excess fat rather than the oxalate. This increases the amount of oxalate being absorbed and deposited in the kidneys, causing the formation of kidney stones, which can be very painful. Now, next we're going to look at the skin. People with IBD can suffer from skin conditions which can be classified based on what triggers them, of which are categorized into four categories. Specific skin conditions are skin conditions that share the tissue appearance as that seen in the intestines due to IBD. Then there's reactive skin conditions, which are conditions that do not share the same tissue appearance, but are instead triggered by the immune system due to reacting to antigens that are found in the gut and the skin. Then there's IBD-associated dermatitis, which are skin conditions that are associated with IBD. And then lastly, there are secondary skin conditions, and these are skin conditions that occur due to either nutritional deficiencies caused by IBD or by the medications used in IBD. So let's have a look at some of these specific skin conditions. You can have a condition called orofacial granulomatosis, which is generally known as Crohn's disease of the mouth, that can make it painful to even eat or speak. Symptoms of oral Crohn's disease can occur before intestinal symptoms develop. And then you can have perianal skin conditions of Crohn's disease, which most commonly display as fissures, abscesses, fistulas, and stenosis. And then there's metastatic Crohn's disease. This is a rare extra-intestinal manifestation of Crohn's disease that causes granulomas to form on the skin, on the lower extremities, as well as the genitalia in both men and women, and can be mistaken for genital warts. Looking at reactive skin conditions, you can have acute febrile neutrophilic dermatosis, which is a rare condition that is also known as sweet syndrome, which causes red, tender skin rashes that are accompanied by fever and neutrophilia. This condition is more common in females between the ages of 30 and 60 years of age and affects the upper limbs, face, or neck. Now, it's thought that one of the causes of sweet syndrome is gastrointestinal tract infection or a reaction to non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs. It can be treated by using topical and oral medications and can heal quickly. And if the cause is an underlying condition like IBD, getting the IBD under control first is enough to improve sweet syndrome. There's another condition called erythema nodosum, which is inflammation of the subcutaneous fat tissues of the skin, causing raised red or violet nodules on that have a bruise-like appearances. It is more common in females with Crohn's disease, and people with erythema nodosum can make a full recovery as it can be treated, with the treatment being focused on what caused it in the first place. Then there's another condition called pyoderma gangrenosum. This is a rare condition that causes painful ulcerations of the skin that can appear anywhere on the body, but more commonly around the legs and around stoma bags. It is more common in those with ulcerative colitis, and despite having gangrene in its name, it's not a contagious or type of gangrene. It can be difficult to treat, but current treatment methods focus on using topical treatments or oral antibiotics, steroids, and immunosuppressants. However, those are the three main conditions associated with IBD, but there are some which are rare and less common which can also affect those with IBD, which includes all of these following conditions, which I have highlighted. Moving on to IBD-associated dermatitis, you can have all of these types of conditions, so psoriasis, vasculitis, bullous pemphigoid, erythema multiforme, and vitiligo. Then we have secondary conditions that can be split into those caused by nutritional deficiencies and medications. So with the nutritional deficiencies, you can have acrodermatitis enteropathica, which is a rare skin condition that occurs due to zinc deficiency. Phrynoderma, which is also a rare condition in developed countries, which occurs due to malabsorption of vitamins A, B, C, and E. Scurvy is caused by not having enough vitamin C in your diet for at least 3 months, which is a rare as most people are able to obtain enough vitamin C in their diet. Then you have seborrheic type dermatitis, which is considered as a chronic form of eczema caused by a deficiency in vitamin E. Then if we look at the secondary conditions caused by IBD treatments and medications, these can include hair loss, skin cancer, which is covered in more detail later on, as well as a condition called Stevens-Johnson syndrome. So to summarize, we've gone over how IBD can affect other parts of the body, which include the cardiovascular system, the eyes, liver, gallbladder, joints, bones, kidneys, and the skin.